This is John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. I have another exciting episode for him here in Baltimore, Maryland at the Real Food Farm. And this farm is actually here in the middle of the city of Baltimore. And, you know, let me just say the drive up here, you know, maybe this wasn't the most affluent area. And what the mission of the Real Food Farm is to make, you know, good food available to the people of the city here in Baltimore. Now, a lot of empty homes on the drive up, you know, and a lot of people are leaving their land, and I think an excellent use of the land is something like this, is to grow food and, more importantly, teach the people how to grow their own food instead of just giving them the food stamps to buy, the processed and junk foods. You know, a lot of big cities in the United States now, you know, are food deserts where there's no good grocery stores and there's no good source of fresh fruits and fresh vegetables. So instead of giving them the food, why not teach them to grow their own food? And that's one of the missions here at the Real Food Farm. So what we're going to do today is actually I'm going to go around and show you guys some of the different areas of the farm here and how they're growing in Baltimore. The first area of the farm that I want to show you guys is actually the fruit trees. They have over 100 fruit trees planted, and you know, fruit trees, once planted and they start producing, will produce hundreds and hundreds of pounds of food every year. Always encourage you guys to grow some fruit trees if you have the space. It might be tight for some people, but if you got the space, fruit trees would be really good. I think this is some kind of apple tree, and I saw some fig trees as well. Next, what we're going to look at are some of the hoop houses. And the hoop houses are what makes growing food here year-round possible. These are actually called high tunnels or hoop houses. And right now the ends are open because it's just coming out of the summer season, the hottest time of the year. And pretty soon they're going to close these ends off, and it's going to stay warm inside even if there's snow outside. So simply by erecting a high tunnel or a hoop house, you can be growing year-round where you live, but you gotta grow the right crop. So let's show you guys what they just planted out inside one of the high tunnels. In this high tunnel here, they planted out some cauliflower. They got some beets just planted out. In addition, they got some Brussels sprouts, some more different varieties of cauliflower, and also some radishes. They got some nice looking radishes over there. So these are all the crops that you can actually grow and plant now in your climate, especially if you had a tunnel like this. If you close off the sides and the ends, they'll continue to grow in the winter even if it's snowing outside, because just the structure alone will keep some of the warmth in so that they can survive. Next, let's take a look at another high tunnel that's actually just finishing up the season that has some of their summer crops. Now we're going to check out one of these high tunnels, and you can see they got a compost pile right next to it. This is the summer season, so the summer season the high tunnel is used with the ends off because they need to get some airflow, otherwise it'd kind of bake in the middle. So they got a door here for the winter, and they're going to probably soon be putting the ends on this, some plastic on the ends. And I want to remind you guys, this is actually the end of the season here, September, and things are kind of on their way out, so it's not looking the best, but let's kind of go inside and show you guys what's growing on. In this high tunnel here, they have about five different rows of crops. Against one edge, they have pretty much tomatoes that were trellised up, and you could see here what they did was they put some PVC and attached it with some standard zip ties to the structure, and then they basically use a string to tie up and train the tomatoes to vine up. Otherwise, they'd be vining all over the ground. So this makes harvesting really easy. Look like on this side and in the middle, they had larger tomatoes, and on the far side, they had some cherries, which are actually still producing now this late in the season. Some of the standard tomatoes, they're just not really doing too good, but some of the tomatoes that are on there are still ripening up. There's one that's almost ready. And one of the things that probably did best for a long season here in Baltimore, right down below here, the peppers. These peppers look beautiful. And actually, if you look closely, it's still even flowering. And if you are gonna grow peppers in Baltimore, my recommendations is to grow the smaller varieties. The smaller varieties of peppers are gonna do much better. They tend to fruit a lot more, make a lot more fruit than, like, you know, big California wonders or larger peppers. So yeah, smaller varieties definitely best. Another thing they're growing here in this high tunnel or hoop house is actually eggplant. So they're actually not staking their eggplant up, which I would probably recommend. It'd keep things a little bit neater. And they're growing a cool heirloom variety of eggplant. This is actually some kind of a yellow eggplant here. And they also got a standard white variety right there. Nice looking eggplant. These guys are looking like they're gotten some good bug damage, but they're still producing nonetheless. Probably the best tomato that they're growing here were the cherries. And as you can see, some of these plants are still actually flowering. and fruiting, and here's some that are almost ripe. While, you know, a lot of the plant doesn't look so good, it's still actually producing. So if you're gonna grow a tomato, I always encourage you guys to grow the cherry varieties. The smaller varieties seem to put out a lot more. I like plants that put out a lot, and they give you a lot of fruit for a longer duration than, you know, the larger varieties that are in the center that actually the plants aren't looking all that great. In addition, I like how they have this basically tied up here. They're using, once again, that same PVC with the string to tie these guys up to make harvesting really easy, but also it maintains better airflow, and in addition, gets more sunlight than being all on the ground, you know. And in addition, down below here, they've interplanted some basil too, which is, you know, nice to eat basil and tomatoes together. What we're looking at now is just part of their composting system. They have many different piles, and compost is happening all over this place. And one of the things they're striving to do is actually, you know, make their land fertile by creating fertility on the land instead of bringing it in. So, you know, make compost out of leaves and food scraps that people, you know, bring by. And they're also using worm composting, and put this on the crops and soil to feed the soil microbes and feed the plants so that they grow, can grow up healthy and strong without buying things like, you know, conventional and chemical fertilizers or even organic fertilizers, but building the soil by using the compost. So I want to encourage all you guys to also compost on your site and create your own soil fertility by composting your tree leaves, your grass clippings, your old plant wastes, and all your food scraps to build your own soil at your home. Now we're gonna show you guys actually the greenhouse and some cold frames. This is where the magic all starts. They start their seeds on site to grow out here. Right now their greenhouse is empty. They're actually drying some corn or some garlic in there. But out front, this is what really makes growing in the wintertime possible, the cold frames. As you can see here, this is just a standard like 2x2 framing here, 2x4 in the back, 2x2 on some plywood, and it's actually up off the ground, elevated. And they got these nice large panels that they could just shut here to keep things warm, especially if there's snow on the ground outside. If you set something up like this to start your seeds, or more importantly, to grow during the winter time, this, even if it's snowing outside, inside it'll get the sun energy and keep it warm in there, especially at night. You might want to open it up and vent it in the daytime so the plants can respirate and get some real fresh air. So a cold frame is an excellent way that'll allow you to grow in the winter. And it looks like in here, they're starting a lot of plants, including broccoli and cauliflower and even some lettuce. And over there is all their seeds they just started. And I bet it's mostly a lot of the same things. Maybe some spinach, maybe some of the brassicas, including cabbage and cauliflower and kale and collard greens, because those are the things they're gonna do well in the winter because they're naturally frost resistant. So here's a table where they're starting their seeds, and this is very important to start your seeds. Don't just start your seeds on the ground because there's a lot of bugs down there. They've actually just built a framing out of 2x4s to raise this up off the ground. They got a wire mesh here on the bottom so it drains down. So it looks like they're growing some mustard greens here, a couple different kinds, and also a lot of different varieties of broccoli, including green magic broccoli, blue wind broccoli, and those guys are definitely going to perform well in the winter. Now don't forget, besides just harvesting the broccoli flower, the florets that everybody eats, you could also harvest the greens and just use them like collards or kale. They're delicious and actually very nutritious as well. Much like at any farm, they also have some beehives, and there's a sign here, "Hi, I'm a honeybee. We aren't dangerous, but we need your respect. Please be careful." And as you can see here, I got a little a bean with a little bee on it hanging out. And I want to encourage you guys, you know, to keep some bees if it's allowable in your area. It'll only increase the pollination of your farm, and also may provide you with some honey. But don't steal all the honey, because the bees need some to, you know, as their food source for the winter. So only take the extra honey. I hope to have some upcoming episodes more about bees as soon as I get my own hives. Now we're in the area of the real food farm, or the field, and this is the field. It looks like it used to be like a baseball diamond. You can see the backstop way back in the distance, and this is a great use of the space. It looks like they're just growing crops in rows over here, and near the baseball backstop, they're actually got some raised beds growing some herbs. So we're going to go ahead and show you guys next what's actually growing in this field, and some of this stuff is being planted out, and some of this stuff is just finishing up as it is. Just turned fall. Now we're gonna show you guys what's growing in the fields here, and looks like they just pulled up some maybe garlic from this field. And they got some tomatoes, and the tomatoes actually outside the hoops actually look a little bit better than the ones inside. And just like the ones inside, pretty much the cherry tomatoes that are over here look like they're doing a bit better than the larger ones. In addition, outside here, they got some peppers. Peppers look like they're doing pretty good. And then they got some okra. So this okra actually looks nice and rich and tall. This okra is like pushing 6 feet tall there. It's got a lot of nice okra here on there, ready to harvest. I think okra does a lot better here on this coast than in California. Mine never get that tall. Over here, they got the eggplant. Looks like it's doing real nice as well. And once again, these are the summer crops that are on their way out, but you can't stop gardening after the summer's over. It's officially fall now, and you can start a fall garden, and that's what they're doing right here in this section. They have things like collard greens growing, some broccoli. Looks like they also got some Swiss chard up over here, and some spring onions, and some spinach. I want to, you know, remind you guys that, you know, here we are in Baltimore, Maryland. It's, you know, middle of September, and they're just planting out stuff, and you guys could plant some stuff out too. Now, what to remember is you want to plant crops that are going to make it in the winter time. So things like tomatoes and peppers, no, no, no. But things like the brassica family, you know, the collard greens, the kale, the broccoli, the cauliflower, Brussels sprouts, cabbage, even things like bok choy and some of the Asian greens, mustard greens, they're going to do pretty good in the winter time. Some of them are frost hardy, and otherwise just put over small little hoops over your little area where you're growing, just to keep it a little bit warmer than outside, especially if it's snowing. Now we're looking at an old baseball backstop. That's what like the batter stands in front of, so the pitcher, you know, overshoots or he hits a foul ball and won't go and hit people. And it's an old baseball backstop. This kind of reminds me of like the Planet of the Apes, you know, after the world's been jacked up and everything's all dilapidated. It's an old dilapidated backstop that's now being converted to grow some food in front of it. Actually, in this area here, they got a field here where they're cultivating where the bases would be to now grow some food. So what better use of a baseball field than to grow food? I think food and growing food and learning how to grow food, much more important in my opinion than the baseball. So let's take a look at what's in these raised beds growing in front of the backstop. So it looks like in this raised bed here, they got a whole bunch of different herbs, calendula, sage, marigold, some basil. Actually, it's looking really good here. Some sorrel. Here's some sorrel. Sorrel, depending on your climate, may be able to be grown as a perennial. And here's one of my favorites. This is actually called a pineapple sage, and it's currently in flower. You can use the leaves, which actually if you scratch and sniff, kind of smells like pineapples, but I like them actually for the little flowers. These flowers the hummingbirds love a lot, so if you want to attract some hummingbirds, they stick their beak in there. And at the base here where it's white, there's a little bit of nectar. I just like to eat that white part out, get that nectar, just a little bit of sweetness. That's what the hummingbirds love too, and I like it also. After you do that, don't forget to eat the flower, rich in antioxidants due to the red coloring. But yeah, the pineapple sage. They got some black-eyed Susans here, great blue labella, and some juncus. Also some gardenias, coneflower, lamb's ear, wild germanium, and here's a fun one, mountain mint. So this mountain mint is more related to the bee balms than a mint, but these are used in cooking and also for teas. Actually, that's got a nice minty flavor. I actually like that a lot. And over in this raised bed, they got a whole raised bed of buckwheat growing. I actually like to take the hulled buckwheat and soak them in water and sprout them and actually eat some sprouted buckwheat. Now, I advise you against, you know, feeding your buckwheat leaves or greens to your cattle or your animals or yourselves. They're actually not too healthy to eat, but the seeds are fine. Security here is at the utmost of concern, and so what they have here, they have actually valves here that have locks, and as you can see, this is actually in the lock position, but yet this is just leaking like a sieve. And actually I've noticed several of these along the property. They're using the same one. These are Campbell, so if you're doing a project like this, don't get the Campbell valves. They leak like a sieve after a certain amount of time, you know. So that actually kind of bothers me that they're actually literally wasting a lot of water here when they could replace this out with some other kind of locking device that actually doesn't leak 24/7 when it's not in use. I hope you guys enjoyed the tour of the real food farm here in Baltimore, Maryland, and how they're growing here inside the city to make food and, more importantly, teach people how to grow their own food. They have many programs here so that you can actually purchase the food or actually even come here for a tour or volunteer and help them out. But at the same time, you'll be also learning how to grow your own food. In my opinion, there's no substitute for real world doing instead of learning from a book. Just get out there and start growing some food today. As you can see, we're next to a fig tree here, and there's one of their hoops, and off in the background is a football field. And I kind of just wonder, will there be a day when, you know, the skill of farming and growing food is more valuable than knowing all the rules and how to play football? That's something I'll leave you with today. But nonetheless, I think that everybody needs to know how to grow their own food so that they can be more independent and self-sufficient in today's world. And I want to encourage everybody out there to learn how to grow food and start growing some food today if you haven't already. And I'm definitely here to help you guys. Once again, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And remember, keep on growing.